fellow intelligentsia of the future free world order. This is Govan here at govankilgore.com. Let me know if that intro is too ridiculous. I can change that. It's just something I kind of came up with to bring about a consistent intro little blurb, I say, at the start of my videos. You probably know I have a different one on each channel. This video is going to be about a very broad topic. I was thinking of breaking this up into several videos, however, I'm just going to wing it, go with it, and to help those who don't want to watch every section, in the top of the drop-down menu below, you can find a short table of contents if you want to skip around to the different sections. The first bit, which just keep watching if you want to hear it, is where I'm going to give a brief breakdown of some basics around genetics and genealogy. And then section two is going to be broadly about several different breakdowns of lineages from R to R1 to R1A or B, R1B, 1B, R1B, 1B, 2A. And it'll get more and more specific up until the third section, which I'll have a link below to skip to if you want to just go straight to that, which is my haplogroup that I discovered in a genetic test I did recently. And we're going to go more in depth into that because it's one that there's a fair bit of information on, but I don't see many videos about it on YouTube. And I think considering there's between 2 and 3 million of us worldwide, men who have this haplogroup, I think some people will get some value from this. So I expect this video within the year to have 1 million views at least from all you guys that have that. No, I'm just kidding. But yeah, for those who don't have this genetic Y haplogroup, you may still want to stick around after that. But if not, I hope a lot of you would get value from the first section, which will mostly be about R1B haplogroups, which is just further back in time. And that is because that's the majority of Europeans. They're actually, the majority of Europeans are R1s, so R1A or R1B. It's about 80% of all of Europe. The dominant haplogroup in Scandinavia and Finland is a little different, and in the very most southern bit of Europe, it's a bit different too. But yes, broadly speaking, R1 is the most common one, and we're going to get into that stuff in more depth, like I said, in that next section. We're going to begin with just kind of talking about what all these numbers and stuff I'm talking about even mean. So everyone knows, I hope, the basics of genetics is that you inherit, obviously, gene material from both of your parents. Men get a Y from their father as well as an X from their mother. Women get an X from their father and an X from their mother. So women are XX, men are YX, and that's interesting in that for men, they have the unique ability, if they trace their Y lineage, to be able to understand exactly where their father's line came from. Whereas for women, you can't as easily tell where that direct line came from of your mother's 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 mother. Because for instance, if, for example, I had a sister and she had the same genetic test done, and she could then use and compare my test to see what my X was, because that was definitely the X I got from my mother, because I got a Y from my father. And looking at hers, one of those X's would be from my father, the other one would be from my mother. However, she could actually have gotten the opposite X from my mother that I got. But if we both got the same X, that meant that was from my mother. But we'd have to then, if we didn't have any similar X's, to have my mother test hers so that we could see which is her X's. And then if we wanted to go further back and test her mother and her father, we could then ascertain where my sister's ex from my mother's line came from. It could have come from her grandfather through our mother. So this is kind of a convoluted way of saying it. I'm not sure if there's an easier way to explain it, but basically the X line of women doesn't go in a direct line always through the mother, because you can get the X from one side of your family from your father, if that makes sense, or from your grandfather. But as populations move around the globe, there is some amount of tracing of X lineages that does take place, but they tend to be much broader regions because, again, it has this different way of being mapped. Whereas the Y lineage, it's you know, very direct. It's always your father's father who gave it down to you. Now, what we have to keep in mind with that is that you're not necessarily going to look anything like your father from 600 generations ago. Obviously not. That's quite far back. But even if you say 30 generations ago, or even just 10, if you and all your relatives were, you know, all in one area and you all were the same ethnicity, but you had some great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, which was from another fairly different ethnicity. So say an Asian man has a child with a black woman, but that black woman's child then grows up and reproduces within the same ethnic group as their mother and so on down the line. The expression of the appearance of the Asian grandfather or great-great-grandfather or great-great-great-great-great-grandfather, whatever point you're looking at, those features are almost going to completely disappear. But if it was always a son that was passed down in each generation that had that Y chromosome, you're going to have a haplogroup that is related to Asia, despite perhaps living in Africa. And you kind of see little bits of this around the world when there's been cases of, you know, someone at some point traveled far before there was large population movements, and thus you have these little pockets of different haplogroups in various parts of the world. So what's interesting about that is you can kind of map the flow, and just because of the nature of men and them generally being the military leaders or the tribal leaders, etc., you can map the movements of population largely by Y haplogroup movements. Now, it doesn't always mean there's all out warfare and like some conqueror just impregnated all the women in some area and slaughtered all the men. It can happen slowly over time. So there's not actually a whole ton of examples where that happens. The Genghis Khan effect, as we might call it, is the biggest example of one man, you know, being so virile that he produced what today is something like 16 million people that can trace their ancestry and be connected to him. And what we'll get to in the third section is actually the group I'm a part of is possibly the second most virile person in history. Is connected to the group I have, which is the M22, or the R1B1 2A1A2B2F2, formerly known as R1B1C7. And that is possibly connected to an Irish king in the 4th century, 4th or 5th century. But it's unlikely he did something similar to Genghis Khan in that he, you know, just kind of went on a rape spree. It was more likely that because he was so prolific and controlled so much territory, he had something like 8 sons, one of his sons who later took the throne had 12 sons, and so on and so forth. So people who have a lot of power and a lot of wealth, the survival of their offspring is higher and greater, plus they have more opportunity to have more sons, and thus that proliferates, and that's how you get it to turn quickly into a bigger population explosion of men for that Y haplogroup lineage. Now, I think that kind of summarizes this basic idea of how genetics are passed down when it comes to the Y and X chromosomes. So in the second section, we're going to look at, you know, going down from R1 and getting more specific down to my lineage. Obviously, feel free if you happen to know yours to break off at any point and do your own research. There's so many sort of cascading lineages, it would take way too long to cover them. Now, when I'm talking about those strings of numbers, that is just the ways that they track genetic changes or mutations. They happen at a specific rate, and thus they can calculate based on the number of changes someone has in their Y lineage or even their X1, if we're talking about tracing that. But yeah, so when it's really simple and we're just talking about R1, that is a long ways back in time because that's the little bit of information that they have that is shared by so many people in that alphanumeric string of sort of classification. So depending on where the differences begin or mutations in that alphanumeric string, I was describing it as R1B, etc., etc. For me specifically, it's R1B, 1B2, A, 1A2B, 2F2. But if we take just the R1 part of that, the very beginning of it, that's, you know, where we're going to start. And we're going to get more specific as we go along. So R1 is the dominant haplogroup in Europe, like I said, and so they've been able to map that it was confined to the continent's southernmost fringes during the last ice age, and it expanded rapidly in the wake of the receding glaciers about 12,000 years ago. Now, I also have to mention, it did exist down in through the Middle East as well. And so various branches of R1 also trace many migrations that have shaped Europe since then, from the arrival of farmers between about 10,000 and 7,000 years ago. And then there's also been ones after that. So one way of thinking about this is that Europe was shaped in three waves, but the third wave was more of a ongoing one. So there was the hunter-gatherers, which are R1 for sure, which is typically thought of as the Cro-Magnon, and they interacted with the Neanderthals. Obviously, there's some mixture going on there. And then the second wave would have been farmers that came up, like it said, 10 to 7,000 years ago. And then later movements would be sort of conquering, not always conquering, but sometimes just gradual shifting into Europe, various lineages, which we'll actually get into in the third section, as that is the origin of my Y haplogroup. So we're going to get a little more specific. The majority of Europeans are R1A and R1B. R1A has the highest percentage of blonde hair and very light eyes. That's more relegated to Eastern Europe, whereas R1B is much more of Western Europe. And actually, Germany is almost perfectly 50-50 in terms of the balance between the two. And R1B does have a high percentage of blonde hair as well. Both these have much higher than all other haplogroups. But they also have by far the most red hair. There's almost none in any other haplogroup. And then you also have the light skin and the other features that are common amongst Europeans. So these are represented in the highest proportions within those groups, and they are connected to those alleles that come with that chromosome. So I'm going to throw a link below, and this is below the table of contents. And this is just a site I use to get some of this information. If you want to look into it more, there's a lot more information that you can read there. And if you are R1 or R1B or R1A, you can find links there to find out more about your specific breakdown. Now, some other little tidbits of information about R1B is that the majority of royalty within Europe is descended from R1B. You can always find really specific things about that. Although, the more recent ones are more hidden, so obviously, the royal families don't want that information to be known, like how much of the specificity of the breakdown is. Otherwise, people could be finding out that they're illegitimate children of royalty in some cases, probably. So you can usually find a couple digits in, but not that many, of what different royal families came from. But because royal families pass on, preferably their lineage through a male heir, you have that Y haplogroup often being a continual thing. So, you know, all of Western Europe, as far as I could tell, the monarchies that still exist or the ones that ended had R1B. The majority of them in Central Europe had them, a fair number, even getting towards Eastern Europe had them. Scandinavia, where I1 is the predominant haplogroup, the R1B seem to be the royal families there. Now, R1B is such a big group, and you're going to have such a big range of people that belong to it. I'm not trying to ascribe some kind of characteristic to it that isn't that. I'm just putting the information out there. The origin of R1B is said to have been Paleolithic mammoth hunters. So I said that R1 was connected to farmers moving to Europe 10,000 to 7,000 years ago, so it doesn't make sense that R1B would be older. That was just the information I found on R1. There's obviously an older actual origin of it. The farmers just happened to be part of that. But there would have been older ones, whether they're in Europe or not, I'm not sure. But R1B, they're looking at the origin of when that mutation happened that distinguishes it from R1A, was around 18,000 years ago between the Caspian Sea and Central Asia. And this was also confined in pockets near the Mediterranean during the last ice age. The largest was in the Iberian Peninsula in southern France, where the men bearing the haplogroup created the famous cave paintings at Lascaux and Altamira. They also hunted mammoth, like I said, bison, large game, in a climate that was more like present-day Siberia than the mild conditions prevailing in southern Europe today. So kind of getting to the idea of diet and what our ancestors would have eaten 18,000 years ago. A lot of red meat. Some men with the R1BY chromosome also seem to have spent the Ice Age in the Balkans and Anatolia, where the haplogroup is still present today. And I ran my genetic information through a different generator. You can download the information from 23andMe and upload it other places. And I had one breakdown. I forget the exact snapshot in time it was looking at, but I had something like 25% Balkan heritage. And I was like, this must be pretty old, because there wasn't anything I saw in my background as being connected to that sort of central, almost eastern part of Europe. And also with my R1B lineage, I don't believe it went through the Balkans, but we're going to get to that in a bit in the next section. So if we're going to get more specific down that sort of string of alphanumeric digits, R1B1B, there was three branches that broke off from R1B. That's R1B1A, R1B1B, R1B1C. I'm from R1B1B. And they all seem to have stemmed from the Middle East, somewhere near Anatolia. Don't have much more information on that. Now, if we're going to get more specific with another digit, adding the two on there, 10,000 years ago, north or south of the Caucasus, and there's a possible connection to one of the original, if not the original, Indo-European tribe, there would have likely been multiple ones within that. So maybe some of the other R1B, 1A, or 1C offshoots were within that as well. And this is that sort of iconic region of probably several tribes that had languages that are the roots of all the European languages, as well as all the Indian or Aryan languages, such as Iranian, Persian, Hindu, or Sanskrit alphabet. These all originated from that point. And this was, again, moving in with the first waves of farmers that would have moved up through the Caucasus in there. And that's when actually the Indo-Europeans would have split apart into the Europeans and the Indos. R1B1B2 is actually the most common haplogroup of that many digits in Western Europe, and it's found in over 50% of all men. Now, I showed some of these pictures already, but we're going to go back through them a bit. This one's just showing the R1B population concentrations. You can obviously, it's far greater in Western Europe, a large amount, definitely, you know, over, in some cases, than over 80% of Ireland, Scotland, western part of England, also western part of Europe. It's high in there in the high 60s, 70s. And you can always look up other maps too, like this. You look at R1A and it's got a similar look, although it's in the eastern part of Europe more. And the next picture here is showing the migration pattern. And the confusing thing is, this really threw me for a loop, is I thought there was way more haplogroups than there are. But what they call subglades, when it gets more specific, they keep changing the names of them. I don't know why they do this, because it took me ages to figure this out. But some of those things like L21 or S21 are the shortened version of those strings of alphanumeric sort of numbers and letters that help identify the group as it becomes more specific. And you can see the migration patterns as well as years. I'm going to zoom in on different parts, and I'm going to use this picture again when talking about the more specific haplogroup that I belong with and the possible origins of it, because it roughly follows this history, this pattern. The years somewhat line up too with some of the myths and legends of the possible lineage I'm going to be talking about. So it's quite interesting in particular is that several times in Europe's history, in the history of European peoples, they came up from sort of the more Middle Eastern areas, Central Asia as well. They might have come down and up through the Caucasus. And I've always wondered why people get called Caucasians. And this kind of answered it. On every sort of growth of the population in Europe, with more additional waves of groups coming in, these were people that would come through the Caucasus Mountains. There's something specific called the Darial Pass in the Caucasus Mountains, which is like one of the only ways to get through. This was also called the Iberian Gates or the Caucasian Gates. And that is kind of how Caucasians are defined. All populations that came in through that area get the Caucasian designation. Doesn't mean they even stayed in the Caucasus region for very long. It just means that they passed through that area. So yeah, that's a little tidbit I hadn't understood before, which I found quite fascinating. But yeah, you had the hunter-gatherer groups that came in through there. You had the farmers going back to the explosion of agriculture. And then you had later groups that came up and into that region too. So we're going to move into the final section. And this is an interesting one in that it's hard to decide exactly where the facts end and the myth and legend begins. So be prepared. This may not be accurate. This is just my own interpretation of these findings and what they might mean and what we can draw from them as conclusions. The breakdown of the haplogroup R1B12A1A2F2 is otherwise known as R1B1C7 or R-M222. So actually, if you even just search M222, you often find a lot of information related to this. There's been several studies, genealogical, genetic studies, that are likely connecting this group, this subclade, to a historic figure called Uniel. It's the origin of the name O'Neill, an Irish name, obviously. And he was known as Niall of the Nine Hostages, or the King of the Nine Hostages. And that refers to him having conquered nine regions. And when they talk about hostages, it doesn't mean it in the sense of we've got someone captive and we're going to keep them captive, locked away in a dungeon. It means because you've conquered a kingdom or another land, you're taking the either the ruler or usually the heir to the rulership of that area, and they're your political hostage, and you bring them up to understand your culture and ways of doing things so that when they're old enough to take on the crown or the chieftain title of that region, they're going to be subservient to you if you were the king that took them hostage because you treated them well. It was actually considered to be an honorable thing in many cases, but in some cases you have rebellion. So you look at a lot of figures in the past. The recent video on this channel I did with the heroic European figures of the past, you heard multiple times some of those people were taken hostage by other groups. So the most prominent one being Vlad Dracula. He was taken by the Ottoman Empire at a young age and raised to fight, and he learned the language of Turkish and all that, but he later rebelled and could use a lot of those things that he was taught against the Turkish armies and helped really drive out that last bit of Islamic invasion into Europe at the time. But apparently, Uniel did this, and that's how he subjugated parts of England, Scotland, Wales, as well as parts of mainland Europe. It was, and other parts of Ireland as well. He was the High King, and he had many sons that carried on his lineage, but he was one of the last pagan kings, because after that it converted to Catholicism, because actually one of his hostages, I don't know if it was one of the official nine, but he captured and brought over someone, I don't believe it was his name to begin with, but he got renamed this, but Patrick, who became Saint Patrick, who escaped and spread Christianity, and it kind of infused it with the paganism of Ireland at the time, the Celtic practices. So if the research is true and I am a descendant of Uniel, this might explain my slight apprehension whenever St. Patrick's Day comes around. I have a bit of a, I wouldn't say a strong dislike or anything, but it's never sat right with me. I've always felt a bit of vehemence to not just the way people celebrate it, but there's something deeper than that that I didn't like about it. I always attribute it to the fact that it was Irish and I have a strong British family, and there's, you know, sort of this bias, obviously, there culturally. But maybe there is something genetic in my blood that has resentment with having made the mistake of bringing this character over to Ireland to have him kind of replace our native religion. Anyways, like I was saying, the subclade is very popular, between 2 to 3 million people worldwide, possibly. In the northwest part of Ireland, it's something as high as 27 or 28% of the population of males. That's one quarter of all males over that. And then as you get outwards to the areas where it also exists, it starts dropping down to like 10%, or in other areas, 3%. It's possibly 2% of all males of European origin in New York City. Now, as for the specifics on Njal's life, I would recommend reading up on that. I'm not going to talk too much about that and the history there, but he was possibly the son of a pairing of his father, but with the second wife that he had, who was almost like a political wife that came over from, some say it was an Anglo-Saxon queen, definitely someone from a royal household, but I don't believe the Saxons had invaded England yet at that point, or at least they weren't that prominent. They had maybe just come over. It's possible it could have been an Anglo-Saxon wife, but in all likelihood, his mother was Britonic, you know, the Britonic Celtic peoples. When the Anglo-Saxons came over, they got kind of shunted down into Cornwall, or, you know, in the northern part of England, so they got pushed up into Scotland. And, you know, any of these figures that I talk about, you can always find them usually on Wikipedia if you want to learn more about them, whether the sons, if you want to try and connect your actual lineage that you can trace by name to him, it may be possible, I don't know. There's obviously going to have been some spillover out of the royal lines, because otherwise you'd be the heir to the Irish throne, except obviously the Irish throne was taken over and fell to Britain eventually. But yeah, that wouldn't work that we have, you know, 1 to 3 million heirs to the Irish throne if it even still existed. But it's maybe something you can talk about, you know, at the pub if you're talking to a group of people, especially if they're Irish. See what they say if you're not Irish yourself. The next link below is an interesting paper I came across in, again, looking into this. And it was talking a little bit more about how the specific subclade of R1B12A1A2F2 could actually be from a little earlier back, however, still in Niall's lineage, but it might be actually connected to, you know, one of his great-great-great-grandfather or something. But that paper is worth looking into if you're really interested in this. But it gets pretty heady. There's a lot of disseminating of complex genetic stuff in there. I didn't understand half of it, to be honest. But near the end of it, if you just want to read the conclusion of that paper, it talks about the Lagan or Fir Domnann, or otherwise known as Dumnani, which were names of tribes, that they likely produced the Connacta tribe. So these were all tribes mapped out by Romans when the Romans occupied the British Isles. And the Connacta tribe is what Niall descended out of. And they controlled Tara, which was near Dublin. It's sort of one of the highest points in the area, which gives a very, you know, 360 degree view. And that's where the High King, sort of the Irish royalty, was set up, because it had that great vantage point. And the Milesians, which is this line for Niall, was some of the longest running royalty in Irish history. And we're going to go back through the lineage, and there's times it breaks, you know, another family of nobles comes in and takes over the High King title, but it always flips back and forth. So I simply did this just by following it on the Wikipedia page, but at a certain point, Wikipedia stopped doing it, and I had to go to other sources, which I'll talk about when I get there. So the next link below is just to Niall of the Nine Hostages, his Wikipedia page, if you want to read more about him. And by the way, if I mispronounce these old Irish names, please forgive me. And so along with Niall, there's also Iocaid, his older half-brother, so from his father's first marriage. And he could also be the source of the M222 lineage, despite not having taken on the High King role. But both Niall and Iocaid were the son of Muiredach. He was the son of Fiacca, son of Cairbre, son of Cormac, son of Art, son of Con of the Hundred Battles. And by the way, I'm just saying their first names. It's going to take too long if I have to go through each name, which is sometimes two or three names long. Son of Fedlimid, son of Tuatal, son of Fiacu, son of Ferradach, son of Lugaid, son of Iacu. And he retook the throne after a period of six generations where they were not the High Kings of Tara, of all of Ireland, rather. So, son of Finn, son of Rogan, son of Esamain, son of Blathnacta, son of Labraid, son of Algnec, and he was son of Aena, and Aena is the one who lost the throne for that period of six that didn't have it. So again, we're still going back in time. So this next series, All Had the Throne, son of Ungus, son of Iokaid, another Iokaid, son of Aelil. And Aelil is actually the one that that paper that I mentioned earlier that puts the M222 lineage further back in time, they're saying it could be actually connected to him. So let's keep going. Son of Conla, son of Irerio, son of Melij, son of Kopnacht, son of Ugain, son of Iaku, son of Dwi, son of Fiaku, son of Art, son of Lugaid, son of Iaku, son of Lugaid, son of Inna, son of Dwi, son of Setna, son of Bres, son of Art, son of Elim, son of Rathektaid. And so he retook the throne after several generations having lost it once again, his predecessors. So his father, Rhone, son of Failbe, son of Cass, were all not high kings of Ireland. But the previous father, Faildir Dwat, he was killed, and that's why they lost the throne for those few generations. And he was son of Muinemon. I just threw in a date here just to kind of give you a sense of where we're at in terms of how far we've gone back in time. So I probably should have thrown in more as we're going. But Niall of the Nine Hostages was around the change of the 4th to 5th century AD. And we've already surpassed and gone before, into BC. And we're at 950 BC. So we've pretty much covered 1,500 years of kings where this dynasty has been the majority of the sitting high kings of Ireland. So this period was, again, like I said, the most dominant. Sometimes there was some of those back and forth. Sometimes within even those generations where I was just saying son of. Sometimes the throne was lost in there. I wasn't too specific as to where that happened. But it was regained just by the son within, without losing several generations of the throne. So it might have been taken for one generation, and then the son of the king that was killed retook it. So to continue, these next couple ones weren't high kings. So son of Cass, son of Irard, son of Rothectade, son of Ross, son of Glass, son of Nuad. None of them had the high king title, but this is still within the same lineage. Now the predecessor that lost it was Iokaid. You obviously see the repetition of several names here, Iokaid being one, who was son of Conmail and son of Eber. And Eber was the first Milesian Irish king beginning in 1287 BC. And the next link below, if you want to read about the Milesian dynasty, this was the start of their reign. So there's no other predecessors that were kings in Scotland, because Eber, and we're now pretty much at the point where this is not tried and true history, we're getting almost into myth or legend. Eber was the son of Mil, hence the name the Milesian dynasty. Mil was a foot soldier in Scythia and Egypt before he received a prophecy that his descendants would rule Ireland, as the myth goes. And so he was, if you want to learn more about him and read about him, he basically came to avenge his brother's death because his brother had gone over to Ireland from Spain, or what is today Spain, back then it was Iberia, had sailed northward and tried to interact and just basically settle in Ireland and was killed by the locals there. So Eber, son of Mil, had set off to avenge his brother, and that's where he took over. And then that is obviously the addition of their reign. Now, they were Gaulish. It said he was a foot soldier in Scythian Egypt, and that's just because when we start the next portion of this lineage going back, we eventually get to Scythia and Egypt. But there was a long period through Europe where all the predecessors were the ruling king or chieftain of various tribes in Gothia, in Gaul, and their kingdom stretched down into what's today Spain and Portugal. And if you listen to the name Portugal, it's Port o Gaul. So the Gauls, the port of the Gauls. And at the very north tip of Spain, there's a monument, which I'll talk about in a second. And that is supposedly where they traveled northward. And if you go straight northward, you hit Ireland. So Eber was son of Mil. Mil was son of Bile or Bil, who was son of Briogen or Breogen, king of Galatia or Galicia. And the Tower of Hercules, which was likely built by the Romans to possibly honor him, or there's some myths that say he built it. I don't think it's that old. The Romans were several hundreds, if not over 1,000 years later, that they would have done it, and that makes more sense in terms of the dating of the building, I think. But there is a statue by this tower that is said to be Breogen. So the next two links below are the pedigree or lineage for the continuance of this line we're talking about. One is fabpedigree.com. That's just one side of it, and I kind of cross-referenced it with the Wikipedia entry by John O'Hart, who was a Irish scholar that traced this back. So we're going to continue on. Breogen was son of Brath of Spain, or Iberia, who was son of Diagatha of Scythia, who was son of Ircada, king of Gaetulia, probably an aspect of Gaul, son of Eloid, king of Gothia, son of Nungati, king of Gaetulia, son of Nenuel, king of Gothland, son of Fraubar, king of Gothia, and we're, at this point we're at 2037 BC, roughly, who was the son of Agnon, king of Gaetulia, son of Elmhir, king of Gothland, son of Lamphion, king of Crete, son of Agnon, king of Scythia. Scythia was north of the Black Sea. It was an ancient empire, which you can look up and read about. Basically, Scythia came up out of the Middle East, but they are what set forth across Europe and became or intermixed with these other tribes that were already there. We'll talk more specifically about Scythia on its own after I finish this lineage. So Agnon was son of Tait, who was the king of Scythia, son of Agamon, king of Scythia, son of Beumen, king of Scythia. And these next three weren't royalty or chieftains. Beumen was son of Aemher of Scythia, son of Siruth, who fled Egypt for Crete, and son of Azroth, son of Gaudel, who was expelled from Egypt following a revolt after the death of the pharaoh. And this was why the next few generations were without a place to rule and live. But then they went to Scythia, the descendants of Gaudel, and intermixed with the nobility there and became the ruling class. Gaudel was son of Nule, who was a king of a country around Greece at the time, and he had married this daughter of the pharaoh. The daughter's name was Skota, of Pharaoh Kingris of Egypt. And so him and the daughter obviously created a son, and that was Gaudel. But when the pharaoh died, instead of the daughter getting rulership or even the son, Gaudel, they were expelled. So continuing backwards, Nule was the son of Phineas, king of Scythia. So we're back around to Scythia in going back in time. And Phineas was the son of Bauth, who became a king, and not sure exactly where or of what. By the way, I've also got links about Gaudel if you want to learn more about him, of Phineas below, as well as Bauth, who was Bauth Mac Magog. So we're really at the point where this is myth and legend. Just take it with a grain of salt, especially with these next names, which you're going to start to recognize. Bauth Mac Magog was son of Magog, and he wasn't royalty in that sense. By the way, I've also got a link below for Magog. He was son of Japhet, who was son of Noah, and at this point we're at 3000 BC. That's when the supposed biblical flood occurred. And so after this point, obviously all the names are a little bit confusing because we don't know exactly how time passed before the flood, because there was supposedly a different passage of time, hence why Noah and these other figures lived so long. It might not have been a regular year. So Noah was son of Lamech, son of Methuselah, son of Enoch, son of Jared, son of Mahalalel, son of Canaan, son of Enos, son of Seth, son of Adam, in 4004 BC. So obviously, we got into interesting territory there. Take from it what you will. There's obviously not anything that clear we can get from that, if it was reality or not. And it's impossible to know for sure, except for what these things say. I'm not totally certain how these original sources got this lineage when we're talking about the John O'Hart who tracked that, as well as that other page. I'd have to look into this further and really understand what they're basing this on. But if for whatever reason you could actually track this and claim there was never a break at any point in this and you had this Y haplogroup, you could trace your lineage to Adam, as in Adam and Eve. Now, obviously, there were, if we're taking the scientific approach, which I hope you definitely are, there was already Europeans alive, more than going back to 4004 BC. So one alternative theory, if there's some truth to this biblical myth, is that, yes, there was the Cro-Magnon and farmers in Europe going back tens of thousands of years. They were very pagan at that point. This third wave hadn't begun, but if these rulers who were all around this area, you know, Scythia, Egypt, and all that, if they had this sudden exodus, that's what it's called in the Bible, the exodus of the various tribes, the Israelites. Now, before you jump to any conclusions, Israelite doesn't mean Jewish. All Jews are Israelites, but not all Israelites are Jews. But it was all the different tribes and peoples that lived in that area and developed in that area. As the myth goes, I believe there's 10 lost tribes. And what a lot of people online talk about is that the sons of Noah, and then more specifically for Europeans, the sons of Japhet, are some of these lost tribes of Israel. Now, the path they took would have come up through the Caucasus Mountains. There's something called the Dariel Gorge, which is really the only path through the Caucasus. There's another one, but that was the main one. And that, like I believe I mentioned earlier in the video, was how the term Caucasian came about, is that all the peoples who came into Europe over all these different waves would have had to have passed through that area, because, you know, that sort of fertile crescent in the Middle East is where it's sort of like the breadbasket or the basin of civilization. All the cultures grew out of that at that time period and went off into Asia. Some went to Asia, some went into Europe, and, you know, the rest is history. Now, when I was looking into this and just saw this lineage for the first time, I was a little aghast and kind of almost like nauseous, because I was like thinking, well, I don't have any Middle Eastern blood in me in terms of the genetic test I had. Is this just complete hogwash? What does it mean? And yeah, if you think about the way populations move, they're not obviously just plowing through and conquering and wiping people out. They move location if they're exiting a region that they sort of developed in, and then they'll plonk down somewhere and they'll live. They'll farm, they'll do what they have to do to live, and they'll interact with the tribes around them. And you have mixing of tribes, and at that point they aren't that different ethnically in terms of their genetics and their racial type. But then if the group still keeps on moving over time, you're going to have that slow, over many generations, interaction with all these different groups. And the next generation that comes up is going to have some admixture, and over time it keeps happening. So if the claim is true that this, you know, 1 to 2 dozen generations, this group made it across Europe, it could be possible that by the end of it, they wouldn't have looked anything like what their ancestors looked like, because there was so much admixture. And when you also factor in how long the reign in Ireland was, well over 1500 years, you had, at that point, the royal lineage, which had come down into Gaul and Spain, or modern-day Spain, they'd already, you know, taken on that sort of Celtic, Gaulish lineage, language, look, etc. And then as they go up to Ireland, they wouldn't have been that different from the people already in the British Isles. Those were Celts already there. They had just come across from sort of the Frankish area, over to England and then over into Ireland many generations before. Same thing, the first European hunter-gatherers would have come over there, then the farmers, all before this sort of paternal lineage came on through. Now, if you also want to track all the offshoots of R1B, because, you know, if we're talking about R1s coming into Europe, and R1B and R1A had split off sort of in Central Asia and then moved in different patterns. Later groups that came in were also R1Bs and R1As, but they were successive sort of mutations down the line of that. And this next image, which I've already actually had up before, will show you even more detail, and I'm going to zoom in on certain parts here. And there you see R1B1, which was in that area, right below the Caucasus, so in between the Caspian and Black Seas. You see the Caucasus, which is that band there. And there's not an actual date there, but that would be roughly around the time that she would have had, you know, I don't know which one exactly, but perhaps King Egnon or Beomen, King of Scythia. These Scythian kings would have been at that time period, roughly in that area. You know, this is looking at a bigger population than just the one lineage, obviously. So there's a whole different assortment of different R1B1s. Some actually split off and went down, and that's why you find some, the RV88, which is a R1B1 descendant, went down into Africa. So there's some parts of Africa that have R1B Y haplogroup lineages. However, anyone that would look at them would say they're African versus someone with an R1B1 lineage in Europe is going to be European. So that's my point in that the diffusion within a population of a paternal lineage can completely disappear from the original appearance. Then the paternal lineage going back, you know, dozens of years. Now what you see with the M269, which is the R1B1A2 group, it comes up and over, and it is at 4200 BCE, going to 2500 BCE. So it was, like I said, sort of a long period of diffuse movement. That roughly falls in line with that time frame I was talking about. You know, I had put the date in there of King Faubar of Gothia at 2037 BCE. So that's, Gothia is already in Europe. It's the Germanic tribes. So you go back several generations, if you're going to talk about 2500 BCE, and you would get maybe King Egnon of Scythia, which was just north of the Black Sea, and that is right at that time period. Scythia would have existed in its sort of slow-moving state in our expansion while the trailing end receded with them. It would have existed right above the Black Sea there. And then as that movement occurred, and you've got the L51 going to L11, which is just shortened names for the different breakdowns of the R1B lineage. And that's saying like 2500 BC, once again, these are very rough time frames. It's hard for the science to put it down really specifically. But that's when you get all these, if this lineage is true, all these king of Gaetulia or Gothland, Gothia, these different names for the Goths and the Gauls, which were the Celts and Germanic tribes or Teutonic tribes. And yeah, there was a lot of going back and forth. The languages are similar. The peoples look similar. People tend to think of Celtic and Germanic as these really two distinct things, but that far back in the past, there would have been a lot more similarities than differences. So that lineage where there's sort of the back and forth, King of Gothland, King of Gaetulia, that would have been political marriages where the son of a king in Gothland would have gone and married a daughter in Gaul and become a king there. And that's why it would kind of jump back and forth when I was describing the lineage at that point. Then you have that L21, which is getting closer and closer to the R1, B1, 2A, etc., etc., the M222 lineage. It doesn't actually have the M222 on here because that's such a specific narrow subclade, but these ones are the predecessors before that one developed. So L21, as you see on the map, it had already gone over to England and Scotland and Ireland, but it also swept down into France and Spain, Iberia at the time, as it was called. So even though that says 2250 BC, the L21 did creep along the northern part of Spain, and you would have had, at some point, eventually, it lines up with the reign of Briogen. That would have been at the very tail end of that, because three or four generations later, you had Eber, who was the first Malaysian or Malaysian Irish king, and that was in 1287 BC. But again, we're talking about myths in that time frame. There's nothing recorded there that can be said for certain. But from then on out, that's when you had the Irish lineage that went on through Ireland, the Malaysian dynasty, which was the largest in Ireland of all time. And they ruled on and off at first, but then more solidly, even a little bit after Niall, the king of Nine Hostages, took power, and his sons, and down the line, up until the point where England kind of ended that rule. So those are the myths, legends, and facts around the R1B1, B2A1, A2B, 2F2 lineage, otherwise known as M222, or RM222. So let me know what you think about this in the comments below. Do you have this lineage? Do you have another lineage? What are your thoughts on tracing your Y lineage, if there's any value to it? Like, what does it actually tell me about myself? Nothing that concrete, to be honest. I find it interesting. It gives me insight into how the world shaped, at least Europe. I had no idea that this third wave was so prominent. And it actually gives me some understanding as to perhaps how monotheism took over Europe, is that there was maybe some sympathy to these ideas of strong patriarchal religion from the Middle East taking hold in pagan Europe, because people, especially within royalty, could trace their lineages back to peoples that left that area, at least the paternal lineage. So yes, you had 99% of their genetics within Europe being European, in terms of up until that point, totally European. And you had this diffusion of male lines, which took over because they had more wealth, more resources to be able to survive. And because it came in through the nobility and diffused sort of downward, it eventually overtook all the Y lineages. Not that every single one died out, but you had sort of this underbed of people that look and were European with these Y chromosomes that originated within the Middle East to that time, you know, even pre-Judaism, pre-Christianity. It was the Israelites who had their own pagan religions, but they became, you know, Christianity and Islam and all that. So that could be some people's reasoning as to why they became religious in the monotheistic sense and gave up their pagan religions. They might have rationalized it in saying that our king became Christian because he can trace his lineage back to the lost tribes of Israel. So that cleared up a big question in my mind around that. Doesn't give me a huge amount of insight into my own personality or things like that, because even with genetic testing, it says I'm 100% European. And I think the majority of people that would have that tested, you're going to see a Y haplogroup that might look like it's from somewhere really far away, but you can have the entirety of your genetics and genetic expression be of the area that you live. And it really goes to show that conquering isn't necessarily about pushing in, having warfare and killing people. It can happen subtly over time, over many generations, where one male line takes over others because it is more prolific for whatever reason. So, like I said, check out those links below. I'll also stick below the full written lineage as I wrote it out. And you can always fact check that and look up individual people within that if that interests you. And yeah, like I said, do look into your lineage however you can, whether it's just tracing the more modern ones from you going to your father, to your father, grandfather, to your great-grandfather and going back that way. There's value in that. Not many people can trace it all that far back, usually into 1700s if you have the help with something like Ancestry.com. But keep a separate file of it so that if you decide to give up the membership, you don't lose that information. If you can actually connect it to a point where then you reach a place of royalty, because I think everyone is connected to royalty at some point in their past. It's not always a direct line, but I think you'd be hard-pressed to argue that there's people that don't have any of that. And the thing is that once you can connect to a royal line or a noble line, they usually have been so meticulous in keeping track of their history that then you can start following it back because it is written en masse like that. Maybe some people aren't as lucky to be able to find that. Maybe some of you are. There's going to be other places you're going to find that you're connected to, depending on where you're from. But this is just a really famous one because someone along the line, most likely Niall of the Nine Kingdoms, was such a voracious progenitor in the sack. So with that, I'll talk to you again soon, and take care, and may you spread logic and reason among the masses.